On Christmas Eve 2025, in the nation of Taiwan, the ground began to rapidly shake back and forth. A strong earthquake had just struck, registering in as a magnitude 6.0, which created peak ground motion equivalent to what is being shown in this simulation. And then, only 3 days later on December 27th, an even larger magnitude 6.6 earthquake struck right before midnight, but despite its higher magnitude, its peak ground motion was notably weaker. Regardless, both earthquakes did cause some damage, with reports of items falling off of shelves, cracks forming in some buildings, and scattered power outages. Yet, there were thankfully no casualties from either event, and the estimated total damage each earthquake inflicted was less than $1 million. While both earthquakes did create some limited potential for landslides and liquefaction, there are several key reasons why these seismic events were ultimately not too harmful. 1. Both earthquakes did not strike directly beneath a highly populated area. 2. Both earthquakes ultimately did not create enough ground motion to cause moderate or severe damage to well-designed structures. And 3. Taiwan honestly has one of the best building codes when it comes to withstanding earthquake hazards. While no structure is 100% earthquake-proof, common sense policy has made them far more resistant to damage. The Christmas Eve magnitude 6.0 earthquake struck at shallow depths of 10 kilometers or 6.2 miles, seemingly occurring on a section of the major Yulee Fault. This fault line is a left lateral strike slip fault, meaning that during an earthquake, the fault line moves almost perfectly horizontally, with the ground on the left side coming towards the viewer while the right side travels further away. This fault line is a minor portion of the nation's East Rift Valley, which consists of a series of fault lines, many of which are strike slip, that altogether accommodate some of the motion of the collision of the Philippine Sea Plate with the Yangtze Plate. Since the Philippine Sea Plate is moving northwest and the Yangtze Plate is moving southeast, it makes perfect sense why a left lateral strike slip fault would form here. In all likelihood, an approximately 8.3 kilometer long segment of the Yulee Fault moved as part of the December 24th earthquake. As for the larger earthquake which struck 3 days later to the north, the reason it produced less intense ground motion despite releasing 7.9 times the energy was related to its depth. The Yulee Fault earthquake occurred in a crustal fault at 10 kilometers depth, while the December 27th magnitude 6.6 earthquake occurred at a depth of 70 kilometers all the way down in the upper mantle. At such depths, much potential energy was lost before seismic waves reached the surface. But why did this earthquake occur in the first place? The answer is that it represented what is known as an intraslab earthquake. Here, the Philippine Sea Plate is subducting underneath a section of the Okinawa microplate. The subducted slab of the Philippine Sea Plate bends as it descends, and due to varying factors, the slab is pulled downwards at a lesser rate the deeper you go. This allows for compressional strain to build up until it is released via a reverse fault on the subducting slab. And that is exactly what occurred on December 27th, with a magnitude 6.6 earthquake occurring on oblique fault that had both reverse fault and left lateral strike slip fault components. Now, multiple aftershocks are likely to occur in the vicinity of both quakes in the short to midterm future, but they should decrease in frequency as the days progress. The odds of either of these magnitude 6 range earthquakes representing a 4 shock to a larger earthquake is low, about 5%, which is just a world average. Statistically speaking, the largest aftershock following a main shock earthquake tends to be about 1.2 magnitudes lower than the main quake. So far, the largest aftershocks for the 6.0 and 6.6 earthquakes have been magnitudes 4.3 and 4.5 respectively. As a final note, I would like to thank my new patron Ben Thayer for supporting my work.